If I may, I would like to share with you a personal reflection on what remembrance means to me, and indeed that cost of the conflicts and wars associated to it. And it starts 20 years ago, as I stood at the Senate half in this city, as a young 15-year-old boy, as I observed the act of remembrance, which I kind of knew what it was about, but I didn't really know what it truly meant. There were crowds of people that filled up the diamond, three or four people deep in some places, many of whom are likely here with us here this evening, albeit a little older, greyer, and perhaps a little wiser. I remember seeing rows and ranks of veterans lined up and looking smart and marching in step. There were three things that I remember and stuck out in my head to this very day and made me think and wonder. The first thing was the regimental headdress, which sat so neatly upon their heads. It was a sea of berries, many different colours, shapes and sizes, and of course the caubeen with the green hackle. All of the cap badges were equally as impressive, so many different corps, regiments and associations. The second thing was the regimental blazers and ties. Again, different colours, crests and insignia, all worn with a sense of pride, purpose and uniformity. When they all stood together, you could see and get a feeling that they were part of something bigger, bigger than any one person. And the third thing was their medals, mounted and shiny, hanging on their chest. Some medals had many clasps, others had rosettes and leaves and row of clasps, all of which were earned with dignity, compassion and professionalism, and no doubt had a story behind every one of them. I was inspired that day by those veterans that were on parade, and indeed the heroic stories I had heard from my childhood of the generations who served in World War I and World War II. There was something so profound about service to others that resonated with me, which soon became a burning desire to serve, so I quickly joined the Royal Irish Regiment. 10 years later, I was deployed on my second tour of duty in Afghanistan as a platoon leader with around 40 men under my command. I knew what to expect as I had been there before. However, we had a rough start this time. Within the first week, two soldiers from my company had been shot by a sniper. The second week, a soldier from my platoon was seriously wounded from machine gun fire in an ambush. Thankfully, they all survived. There was one day in particular which I found myself in the middle of a ferocious battle, a gun battle with the enemy. I was drenched in sweat, engulfed in dust and dripping with blood from an enemy grenade which exploded. It knocked me to the ground and sent shrapnel into my body and into my face. When I was lying there, it was in that moment that I felt that rush of adrenaline, determination and focus to get back up, dust myself off and wipe away the blood, and to lead my men as they were still in the fight. There were no vengeful or hateful thoughts at any point, just a moment of absolute clarity of motivation. I cared deeply for my men. I couldn't bear the thought of letting any of them down. I had a compulsion to encourage, inspire and reassure them. The bond between us was fostered in war and conflict and sealed with blood. This bond of camaraderie goes beyond the battlefield and applies equally to all of my fellow veterans. They are my brothers and are my sisters for life. They were from all walks of society, different backgrounds, cultures and religions. Most of them were from Northern Ireland, some from the Republic of Ireland, with a few from Great Britain and the Commonwealth. Every one of them was a character, and I trusted them with my life. They reflected the best of society and set an example that we can all learn from today. Mutual respect and tolerance, selfless commitment and service to others. There's nothing new in what I've just said, as over 100 years ago, both Ulstermen and Irishmen from the 10th and 16th Irish Divisions and the 36th Ulster Division had these same attributes and characteristics during the Battle of the Somme. So today, I stood at the Senate half as a local veteran, nothing more and nothing less. And when I observed the act of remembrance, I reflected on those same three things that I had noticed 20 years ago. Only this time, I now know what remembrance really means to me. The regimental headdress. Now I know what lies beneath these berries and corbeans inside the heads of our veterans. As even though our men and women have returned from wars, let me assure you, for some of them, their battle continues. Silently, mentally, unknowingly. At the Somme, they called this shell shock. Today, we know it as post-traumatic stress disorder. And it is as every bit as powerful and destructive as an artillery shell or a bullet. The regimental blazer, now I know what lies beneath. It hides away the physical wounds from war, the grenades, the gunshots, the explosions. It covers the aches, pains, and scarring. The outside of the blazer is still worn with pride, but on the inside, there are patches and stitches of guilt as to why we made it back and others did not. Third thing was the medals. Now I know what hides behind them. The medals hang in front of and distract you from the heavy and broken hearts for those who have paid that supreme sacrifice, leaving behind so many loved ones. Sons and daughters, brothers and sisters, parents and partners, who now wear those medals with immense pride on the other side of their chest as a stark reminder to us all. Congregation, I leave you with this. Remembrance is precisely that, to remember. Nothing more, nothing less. It does not glorify war, but it marks the ultimate sacrifices made in war. We use the poppy to signify this. To wear it is a choice and a privilege, lest we forget.